crucified on that cross, and others, you came back to life. You were resurrected. Amen. For our eternity, for our salvation. Lord, we give you praise for that. Lord, lift up this service and give it to you. Thank you for Brother John as he would lead us in music. Brother Robert, as he would preach us, Lord, we ask you to bless him, hide him by the cross. May his words be your words, not his alone. Thank you for those that serve here. Thank you for this congregation. Be with those that are away today. Be with those that may be traveling. Be with those that are at home, Lord, worshiping online with us. Thank you for that opportunity. Thank you for technology that allows us, in the midst of everything going on, Lord, there are those that can worship with us online. And just thank you for that, Lord God. We just ask you to return and to bless them in their time of need. Bless them, Lord, as they make preparations and walk through this together, Lord. We will be there with them as their church family. Lift them up to you, Lord. May you be all that they need at this time, Lord. And in the days to come, Lord, we just ask you to touch them only the ways you can, Jesus. Help us to be hands and feet of our church family. In this situation and in any others that are needed, Lord God, we just want to lift them up to you. Ask you to touch them in a mighty way, Lord. We give you the service. We give you all praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. As the praise team comes, you'll stand with us this morning and worship the Lord together. The psalm says, give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever.
Thank you.
came in excited, or he came in kind of burdened down by things that you see on social media or the news. But let us remember to go back. Let's go back to the Word of God.
Next week, we will have, well, we will be speaker, and the evening of the
famous chef.
It's been on TV.
It's famous to me.
What about this? What do you do with this? What do you do with that? You build a carpet. You build things with that. Yeah, that's what someone who uses this might work with. And how about this?
Paint.
Paint, sure. You might paint walls. You might stain cabinetry. You might stain your porch or your deck or whatever. But that's a tool that you might use with the work. And it's kind of playing off the whole concrete and frame themes from this past week. If you saw these hanging up around, and if you were here, Brother Johnny, and I believe son-in-law, right, Johnny?
Master
Chris, out of actual hard hats, because they both work in the construction industry where you are required to wear a hard hat so that you don't hurt your hard head. I'm not saying anything about you, Johnny, that hard hat guy. Boys and girls, we are called to jobs. And I kind of want to think about it in the church too a little bit this morning. The Bible says in Colossians 3:23, it says, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. That reminds us that no matter what we do in life, whether it's a volunteer type job, or it's our actual occupation we get paid for, our view as a believer, as Christians, should be to work as though we're working for God. And when we think about that, when I think about that, I think, man, I got to do my best. Because God has given me His best.
Amen.
And that doesn't mean I always do. That's my standard. That's my goal. I'm going to try to do my best according to what God wants. Now, I have an earthly boss. Fortunately, over the years, I've had some great bosses. So I cannot complain about my bosses. Really been blessed with the people who have been in authority over this. Sometimes that's not always the case in life. Sometimes we have some that might not be the best in the world. But when we look at it as though we're working for God and not for man, even though it might be difficult, the person we work for, that can sometimes help us. And you think about the church. I think about sometimes the job we don't see, right? We probably see, of course, their actual staff members here. We see John and Stacy and the things they do. And there's probably a lot of stuff they do that we don't think about they do. We don't see that they do. Oh, so I had to do that to make this work, do this, that, and the other thing. And what I want to talk about, boys and girls, is sometimes the jobs you may not see that are getting done around here. Like, you may not see the fact that Ralph and Johnny were up here yesterday working on the parking lot. You know, we've got potholes, and those two men were up here in the nice, cool weather yesterday working in the parking lot, repairing those potholes. There's still a little bit left to do, but that's things you didn't see. We didn't, none of us saw, except Ralph and John, unless you came by yesterday. Or there may be others that. I know there are times when some of you may come up here and do some extra cleaning, or something needs to be repaired. A lot of times the building and grounds, those things don't just happen. Somebody has to do those things. Sometimes we don't necessarily think about the job that Zachary and Tommy are doing this morning. And the sound booth. One of the things, in order for the PowerPoint to work, the sound to come on, you need those people to do their jobs. Those are volunteer positions. We're not paying them, right? But that's the thing, what they're doing, though, is they're doing it all for the glory of God. It's a part of an act of service to Him.
Amen.
And when I think about that, I'm reminded of the memory verse. And if you remember this week, the kids were working on a verse. It said, I hope I get it right, because they were pressuring them to memorize it. But it says, I'm sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. And that just means to me that when we come to Christ, it begins your journey. And that He wants us to kind of work with Him and work through our lives on that journey, not to the point where we stay, the Bible might call us spiritual, but He wants us to mature in our faith. And we do that through the things that we do. We can't sit still, if you will. Service is being active, you know. And that's not the same for everybody. math or whatever, or whatever you do. Work for a fence company over here. Or your teacher or whatever. It doesn't matter. But we do it to the best of our ability. Boys and girls, your job is to be a student right now. Do it to the best of your ability.
Amen.
Whether you're going to be online still or you're going to be on site here, your job is to be the best student you can. And if you're in church, whatever role you find yourself in, do it to the best of your ability. If you don't find yourself at all, look for something that you can do. Look for somewhere you can help, that you can be active and serve in the church. Yeah. I mean, obviously we're not the world's largest church in here, so it takes different ones doing different things. And that's okay. That's what God called us to do and God's called us to be. But let's try our best to give our best to God, as boys and girls and as adults, in the areas he's asked us to serve. I'll get down. And again, working is for the Lord, not for man, doing it all for God's glory.
Right. Amen.
Father in heaven, Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity to serve and to work. God, you bless us with the ability to learn and to get educated, to work in jobs, whether they be jobs in construction or teaching or medical or entertainment, customer service, retail, whatever our jobs might be. But you bless us with that we can do our best in those jobs. Lord, in the church, when we serve, when we're ushers, when we serve on praise team, when we work in sound and visual and media, when we work in the Sunday school group, we're just building and grounds. Lord, you want us to do our best with you. Lord, help us to be reminded of that. Help us all to find our places to serve. Our service areas are not all going to be the same, Lord, but help us to work. Even as boys and girls, there are areas that if we're interested in, we can ask if we can help. Well, thank you for all the work that's been in the Vacation Bible School this past week. Thank you for the sharing our leadership and all those who helped her. Thank you for the teachers. Lord, we thank you for the 11 to 12 children that we were able to minister to, share the good news of Jesus with. Thank you for a great week. Thank you for work. Thank you for how much you bless us with everything we have in our lives.
Amen.
We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, buddy. So praise team will come back up. Let's sing one more song before we Brother Robert Cornell comes up to preach, and I just want to introduce him a little bit before we sing, before he comes. I met Robert probably several years ago in Loganville, just going through a store, and I happened to run across a cashier at a store in Loganville, and we kind of struck up a spiritual conversation. It's like, no, that man's all right. You know, I walked off, and just thought, that's amazing. I got another Christian brother there, and it wasn't, you know, maybe probably a year or two later that he came and visited with Johnny at church here on a Sunday evening a few times, and he expressed through Johnny that the Lord had put a call in his life to preach and share. And so he began to kind of work with Johnny down at Cambridge. I think preaches once a month down there with Johnny and Lyle, but he's visited here at Westside several years back when we used to do the dinner and the Bible study. He would come often and just would break bread and fellowship with him. So you may have met Robert before, but he is an ordained minister and he's still called to just preach and share the word where the Lord has planted and put him.
Amen.
So he wanted to come and share with us this morning. So after we sing, you'll just welcome him with a great welcome from Westside like we always do. And just lean forward and say, you know, what do you want me to hear this morning from Brother Robert Cornell? So let's continue to worship. Let's sing. Just gonna sing one song. This one of my favorite hymns. If you'll stand, and this is "It Is Well with My Soul." I love this hymn, and I know you do as well. So let's just worship the Lord together.
Yeah.
we say, it is well, Lord, it is your will. Lord, we can take comfort, Lord, in the midst of difficult times and circumstances. We know that you are sovereign, Lord. You are in control.
Amen.
There's nothing that takes place that you're not aware of, that you are not fully understanding, Lord, even though that we, as finite humans, will scratch our heads and wonder, Lord. You know everything, Lord. May we rest in that comfort. Lord, we thank you this time. We can lift up our voices and worship and sing to you. And Lord, I just pray as Brother Robert will come this morning, I pray that you would use him, hide him behind the cross. Lord, give us a message that we can take hold of that will help us as we trod through this life day in and day out in our community and in our culture this morning. Thank you for bringing him here this morning. I pray all these things in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. People said,
the moment God put the humans on earth, that God has a plan in place
knew what was going to be taking place. From the Garden of Eden, we knew there was trouble. The devil, who cast out of heaven, was a powerful angel, cast out of heaven because of his foolishness, his sin against God. Landed right there in the Garden of Eden where God, okay, that's where I want you. And you do your thing, and I'm still in charge. We know mankind, Adam and Eve, fell apart. But then God, I tell people, it wasn't so much as whether it was Adam or Eve. God was showing that humans, it could be Steve and John, Steve and Mary, Mar and Kim. It could have been any man, and husband and wife, would have failed. But God showed, he said, I got Jesus. He introduced, Jesus was introduced. He said, the Son of Man is going to come, and he's going to bruise that head of that devil. Explaining that God has a plan in place. Now today, and I would like to understand that the fruit of the nine elements or the tricks of Christ, or the fruit of the Spirit, they don't just happen. You just get joy and joy and all. They all work in accordance to each other. Love, joy, peace, long suffering. All those work in accordance. You don't so suddenly get joy. You just get love. How do you think about this? You think about it. I said, look at how I got it. Love is listed first. Love is a foundation point for the fruit of the Spirit. Amen. You're not going to have no joy in your life if you treat people like hell.
That's right.
You're not going to have no peace in your life. No joy in your life. You talk about joy today, you talk about joy. You know, people got to be real. That's one thing when I hear preachers, I say, that preacher, Lord, be real. Let me hear some real stuff. No, you can no pie in the sky and that cake and that's not obtainable. Break it down to earth. That's what I think God used to be. I'm a down-to-earth kind of preacher. I think like Jesus, he didn't break down the earth. Look, or let John the Baptist show you Bible. Why y'all come out here to cast stones at my to belittle this sermon I'm giving out here? Jesus spoke his mind, spoke the truth. We need to hear the truth today.
Amen.
We need people to understand when you walk up out of here, this is not heaven. I tell people, no, you're on earth. There's a movie called After Earth with the great actor, Will Smith, and his son. I remember there was a message that he gave. He said, look, when they landed on earth, he told him, he said, this is your son, this is earth. Everything on this planet on this parable will kill you. Let me tell you, today, this is earth. Everything on this planet has potential to kill you, to hurt you. But then that's when God steps in there through the Holy Spirit. God puts protection. He said, this ain't heaven. He reminded him, he said, it's not heaven. I put the Holy Spirit for those who were saved. The Holy Spirit, we're talking about joy and joy today. We don't talk about the joy and the fruit of the Holy Spirit. That ain't going to save folks. You might get saved before God gives you those blessings, develop that fruit developed in you. You can't become more like Christ if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. So today, this message right here, the doors of the church will be open after the message. But you will not be able to fully rest this message until you accept Jesus Christ into your life. And accept the fact that he died and rose again to give you everlasting life. So that's the foundation right here. This message right here is for saving you and people that want to get saved.
Amen.
People not saved that want to get saved. The saved folks, we definitely always need uplift. Now, to the title of today's message is, where is your joy and how much of it do you really have? You walk in and tell people, oh, I'm joyful, I'm a Christian, I feel good. Yeah. But deep down within that spirit, how are you doing? How is your joy? And when I always say joy, I always should remember, I'm talking about the other fruit of the Spirit, but I'm going to focus on joy, but they're all connected. I want you to understand it, and I will say that throughout the message. These other fruit of the Spirit besides joy are connected. They do not work in isolation. They work hand in hand through the Holy Spirit developing you as you live and you strive and you dedicate yourself and commit yourself to Christ. That fruit through the Holy Spirit develops in you. You can't just say, I want love in my life. No, well, it comes by a struggle for you becoming more like Christ, trying to commit yourself, trying to dedicate yourself, trying to work the work that Christ has given. None of these fruit of the Spirit come to you because you are a lazy, shiftless Christian, a wannabe, playmaker. No, this comes, the Holy Spirit, you grow by putting forth strong fruit. that.
Amen.
You can't do it on human effort. Work, good work, my good works will give me some. No. God will touch you, and then you can, good works are produced from, inspired from the good works, from the power that God puts in you. Then the good works come forward. If we have to have good works, the good works will say the good works are the evidence that God is working in you.
Amen.
That's right.
Now, today's main scripture will be from Philippians 4:4. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Supporting scriptures will come from Philippians 4, 5 through 8, Galatians 5, 22 and 23. God utilizes Apostle Paul under the guidance of Jesus to write the joy letter known as the Book of Philippians. And this book was written, or the letter was written from Paul, by Apostle Paul, when he was in jail. He had been suffering no pride, no cause of his own, because he was preaching the word of God, preaching the word of Jesus, preaching about God, and they didn't like it. So the Romans imprisoned him because of those Israelites that did not want like Jesus. Imprisoned him. He's preaching a false preaching. He's preaching falsely. Talking about blasphemy, talking about the Son of God, all these things. And he was in prison. But now he was, when we look at this, at a time he's talking about joy to the Philippian people, Philippian church, trying to uplift them, but uplifting them from a jail cell. Him showing truly that joy is not dependent upon your circumstances.
Amen.
That's going to be important. Remember that. Joy is not dependent upon circumstances, your circumstances, that are about you. We're going to contrast that to Paul. Now, and also, too, I'm going to say it like this. That joy only comes from the Holy Spirit working within you. The world can't give you no joy. Now, what the world can give you is called happiness. You give somebody $1 million. Let's say you give somebody this or that or whatever. Woo, I'll get happy. Woo! Happiness is based upon good happiness. Happiness is, now God's not against happiness. You know, somebody give you this or that, or whatever you get the new house, or you're able to jog, you're able to run and jog 10 miles, and you're able to catch two or three kicks to somebody, run away. Oh, that's not it. You know, the happiness, is God's not against happiness. But happiness is limited because what happens when good happenings are not happening? Unhappiness is what happens. If you just have happiness, when good happenings stop, you become unhappy. But if you are a child of God and you are striving to become stronger and stronger, the Holy Spirit will develop joy. Joy is that quiet self-assurance that God loves you, that he's got your back, and he's working a work in you, regardless of the circumstances. And then when your happiness runs out, that joy will say, look, oh, it's okay. So they took my smile and threw my money out. My money's gone. Oh, Lord, my life's going to turn into shambles. It's a raggedy old car now, but I can't afford another one. But, oh, I got that joy. I got, the Holy Spirit reminds you, there's joy inside. You got joy. It's not dependent upon your circumstances. You understand that joy is that groundwork for life. And then I'll say, with that, you got the other, remember the other H, love, peace, long suffering. All those are working together. And I'm just focusing on joy, and I want to keep them, let you know that they're connected. So when you talk about joy, you also, this can apply to the other eight fruit of the Spirit, aspects of the fruit of the Spirit. They are traits of Christ. The fruit of the Spirit are those traits that Christ wants us to have.
Amen.
You become more Christ-like, God wants you to have that fruit of the Spirit to develop in you, to become more Christ-like. Now, as you know, the fruit of the Spirit is supernatural.
Amen.
It is not bound by humanity. It's not bound by the devil.
Right.
Joy is operating and is granted under Spirit. Galatians 5:22-23 state, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such is there no law. In other words, when you're doing that right there, the law is not going to hurt you. There's nothing against you right there. You are following what God prescribes. If you are getting the fruit mature through the Holy Spirit in you. You can't just say, I want love. No, well, it comes through the Holy Spirit. You try and you live it. You become extravagant, dedicated, trying to be more like Christ. Oh, I want joy in my life. I want joy. He said that he loved God all day long. Extremely want joy. But you better get off the hill and walk down here and get in the service of God. You know, God has given us a great commission. I need you all to get up and get out. Tell people about Jesus Christ. Preaching, teaching, bringing the baptism. Oh, God, I said work. Oh, you been talking about, the brother talking about work today. Oh, that's our job. Our job is to work the great commission.
Amen.
God has given us talents, given us skills, desires to work. Jesus, God work, creating the heavens and the earth. 6 days, the seventh day, a day of rest, not because you're tired, because it's time to just relax a bit. Just bring it down. Same thing here. Jesus Christ walked away. I like to say this about you. Jesus, people, you don't know that Jesus walked between 20 and 25 miles a day in his ministry. And I asked God one day, I said, Lord, when I was sitting there as a lay person, I said, Lord, some things I have never heard. I never heard that Jesus walked, that Jesus really worked. And he started working at age 12 as a carpenter's son, as a apprentice, age 12. Jesus worked. Oh, you know how many times I've heard that preached? You know how many times I've heard preached that Jesus walked between 20 and 25 miles? What's the significance of that? What's the significance of that? Oh, you're supposed to be in shape. You hear that about, I guess one thing I had preached that pastor smoked, had something overweight. You didn't hear nothing about that. Now you hear nothing about that. The first one that preached. I had a chance when I was a young person to a minister. I said in a sermon in Old Testament, I asked, why is it that you've got to overcome that preacher pastor? How come you did the pastor? Jesus was a hard worker. He walked that ministry. Now, and after what's the ministry that too? Jesus would have had commanded 10 Cadillacs, 10 horses or mules. He could have put all his people, all his disciples, on horses and mules in a buggy. When he said about my shoes, guess what? Get that your shoe off. Your shoes off. Get that shit out. You need to go on that road here. Now, you know why? One reason why again? If he did not, I'll tell you why. I know why. Let's say Jesus had five donkeys, five horses. Then the pastor, the preacher would say, oh, Jesus had five donkeys. I got five cats. I also got five. He had five horses. I got five Mercedes. Jesus had a big old house in here. He had a big old house. Jesus had another big old house in here. Oh, I got a big old house. As a matter of fact, I got my 3 or 4. He got 3 or 4 big old houses. God shows you that Adam had, he said, not against, well, he's against you. Flounder, he's against you. Let that be a God in your life.
Right.
Jesus showed what you need, but the basics, what you can get you through. Mm. You don't have to have all that. As a matter of fact, you tell the church, sometimes you get wealth, they can't have it. Now, joy, as with the other 8 traits of the Spirit, are granted and developed by the Holy Spirit in the believer in accordance to the level of diligence and commitment. Let's say that again. The level of growth that you do is due to your level of commitment and dedication. If you pray for 2 minutes a day, you serve for 2 minutes a day. You fast for maybe a 30 seconds. You do that. You see a letter run across the street. You say, oh, let somebody else walk across. You see somebody on the side of the road, and bust it up. Let the next person do it. You're bypassing all your opportunities right there. Your level of growth is based upon that. Let's reverse that around. Oh, let me pray. I need to pray. What does it say, pray? What does God say, pray? Always. What is it in their need of service? When? On special times? Oh. On what about on Sunday? What about on Saturday? If Or you see somebody that's in need. Somebody that had to go to Jerusalem, stop on the side of the road, and I don't know how. But let's say you see a person on Sunday on the side of the road right there, and you walk, but let's say you walk right by them. Oh, look, he did it. Okay, that's okay. Let the next person take care of you. Brother, this person said, but brother, can you help me? Let the other people help you. I can't, you're too smelly. I don't want to fool with you. Now, you reverse all that, and you are like a good Samaritan. You try to help. You try to pray continuously. You say, Lord, you fall. You say, Lord, forgive me. Or you can say, Lord, I've sinned, but I'm all right. You know I'm okay. You know what my heart is. I don't sin. As a matter of fact, I never sin. I don't fall down. Man, do you know how many times a day you've been sinning unintentionally? Looking at somebody, how about looking at somebody wrong? How about thinking about somebody wrong?
Yeah, amen.
You may not say a word to somebody, but you can hate them. You can mistreat people by not even, look at that person. It's time for realness. This message right here. Because you know, I tell people, look, you ain't got no time. That's one thing about Pastor Doug. I always this person over right here. When I was preaching to these folks over here, I look at them and I said, look at y'all got help. You're supposed to be the 70s, 80s, 90s. I said, y'all blessed. You know that? I said, Dad, look, you're trying to get to that point. You're trying to get to some age on you. You're not guaranteed to get to the next point. You're not guaranteed to get their age on you like that.
That's right.
But God expects us to work. He's expecting us to grow, that he can grow you up. Now, let's look at this. More of the Holy Spirit develops these nine traits in relation to one another. In other words, joy will develop in relation to love and the other seven elements of the fruit. Furthermore, joy, along with the other eight elements of the fruit, develop over one's lifetime. I got news for you, people. You don't get all the love and all the fruit of the Spirit in one shape. As a matter of fact, I have another word that blesses you. It's non-ending. What you are in right now, when you join Christ as your Savior, you join a perfect relationship.
Amen.
You're in a perfect relationship. You're in a perfect relationship, but are you perfect? Let's say, you're in what we call a perfect proper state. In other words, you're in a state right now where you are perfect progress, where you are growing. It's a growth process. Some days you say, Lord, I don't feel like praying at all, Lord, and the Holy Spirit has to carry you on. Lord, I just feel like keeping everybody, keep the sand in everybody's face. I don't want to do nothing today. Now, if you've never had that experience, you're lying. Lord, I don't feel like, oh, Lord, that God has said, sometimes I've got to go to sleep this time. I just have to go turn the TV on, go sleep. Can you please go sleep? Relax. We'll give it to you in the morning. I need you to rest. The flesh is rising up too much. I need you to rest right now. Or sometimes we'll start to tell you, go to a small spot that they pray with you. Sometimes you can't pick yourself up. God has to pick you up. Sometimes you so far you fall flat on your back, on your face. And God has, through the Holy Spirit, has to inspire your body to pick that. Sometimes physically, God will work you physically. And so that's kind of like giving you some physical, some supernatural strength to get up and want to go. But sometimes when your face talking a bunch of talks, cussing you, the Holy Spirit, that flesh rises up, the Holy Spirit says, hey, I got you. You got more power because you are saved. And if you got more power over the flesh than otherwise because you are saved. Use that authority to not go to pieces. That joy ain't gonna just happen to you, people.
That's right.
People think that joy, oh, I just want some joy. I want joy. It's a developmental process. I say one thing, you start the process. Start moving. They don't just become a powerful joy person overnight. It's a point, it's developing. You don't suddenly go from first grade to 12th grade in 1 year or one moment, do you? That's a continuous growth process until the point where Jesus comes to life. Jesus comes to life. If you're still living, you should be developed right to that point. Now, that's the good part, the exceptionally good part, exceptionally good part. When Christ comes back to earth, right now this is a perfect process, this is your growth development. But when Christ comes back to earth, he calls the dead up, the living up, the dream in the air, that's what you get.
Amen.
The glorified body, you get that perfection is there again.
Amen.
To this point, we're developing. Now that I have laid a foundation to show how the nine elements or traits of the Holy Spirit developed in a believer, let's look closer at the element of joy. Paul exhorts us to always be joyful. Only joy can always be existent even during the bad times. Remember that happiness only can exist when times are good or good happiness. Conversely, bad happiness produces unhappiness. But I had told you, if you have joy from the Holy Spirit, from that joy, that true joy, not the joy from what the world says you use the joy, but that ain't no true joy. I'm talking about the true joy from God. Joy is from God through the Holy Spirit. But if you have joy from the Holy Spirit, you can remain joyful during the good and bad times. Bad times, you can say bad times, some of the trials and tribulations. Some people don't call them bad times, they're trials and tribulations of life, but they feel bad, they don't feel good. Don't be walking in line and say, oh Lord, I feel good. Woo, I lost my job. Oh, I was late. It's a little too much here. They told me to leave and get up out of here. Or I got laid off. Oh, that's not going to be happiness. That's not even happiness. Said, don't be wrong. That's not happiness. But you can say, Lord, I know. You're going to take care of me somehow, Lord. Let me go on out here. That joy is gone. That happens. The moment it happens without the women, the joy is always a fountain. Boom. I caught the happiness. Okay. There, we got you there. I got you. There's a joy there. You know that God has your back? He's going to take care of you. They may feel painful at this point. But you understand that God has your back. The faith, you better put that there. The faith is one of those fruit of the Spirit. The faith has to continue to develop. Think about the love that God, you have the love, you have a lot of love. Think about the patience, the long-suffering. I can do it. That long-suffering, that patience. I can make it, though. I don't got laid off. I can make it, though. God is with me. I'm not giving up. The Holy Spirit will kick in there. Start growing in there. Start building that joy up. And sometimes, in many cases, hardships in life, trials and tribulations, are a very powerful tool that God can use to develop you as a Christian. Believe me, if you got somebody that's giving somebody money, throwing money at their feet, throwing good health, throwing it, and they don't have to do nothing for it, you know how that person becomes like a wasted, no good. You give money to somebody that's keep throwing money at their feet. Pretty soon they walk around. I need some more. Give me some more money. Give me some more. Keep on feeding somebody that don't give them that have an obligation they have. Keep friends, children, friends. Keep on feeding them the things that don't require them to do any chores. They don't do nothing. They're pulling up the sewer. And keep it cool. They will say, they're going to get your food up and to live like they want to live. I'm trying to plug you to live right, to be godly. I'm trying to be a godly person. And we're going to do your schoolwork. That's why I told myself 15 years, I said, no, you're going to do your schoolwork. When you can't, you're going to have to find alternative places for you, maybe. You're not playing around. We're not playing. God's not playing with us. God, we should not play with our children. Because life is real. You get out here and you are not prepared for life because you have been a low, a no gooder, a lazy child, a lazy person. Life is going to chew you up and spit you out. You will have a rough time. Now, in Philippians 4:4, see, if you look at Philippians 4:4, I won't say the whole Bible, but God says, look at me, keep it up, the whole 4:4 right now. The whole Bible has everything you need to uplift you. But right there, God said, focus on 4:4. What does he say? What does Paul say? Does he say rejoice when you only feel good? He says rejoice always. He says rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Notice how Apostle Paul did not say be joyful and enduring only during good times. when bad things happen, if they, that's a true test right there. If bad things happen and you go to pieces, you're probably just had happiness. You didn't have that strong confidence with joy. Remember, joy is a quiet self-assurance that God has you, that God loves you. He's got your back. He's going to help you through. And y'all spoke about Philippians 1:6. When God starts a good work, that's Philippians 1:6. Spoke about how God starts to work through Jesus Christ. He said, I'm going to finish it.
Amen.
You can't finish the work by yourself.
That's right.
In other words, when you get salvation, you couldn't keep your salvation without God intervening.
That's right.
No, that will make that, and then your flesh will keep it in salvation if it was dependent upon that. No, God says, I will keep you. And that's one of those things that when that joy comes in here, realize, look, ooh. Now, see, study the scripture too. That's part of one of the study God's word, study to show, yourself to be approved. Study the word of God. How do you really like the word like Jesus if you don't study no word? You don't come in no service, you don't study. That's part of that diligence and commitment into becoming more like Christ. How do you become more like Christ? You don't know about Christ. You don't know what God's commandments, what God's standards of living are. I don't know about the standards of the world. I'm telling you what, if I don't know about the standards of the world, I'm not going to say what preacher, what pastor said, but I need you to read my pulpit, I need you to full suit. Now, I'm telling you one thing. I put the towel, I said, put the towel, you make it up. You can dress relaxed. I said, Lord, I really don't want to do that. I don't like wearing a suit. I do not like wearing a suit. Do not like wearing a suit. But when pastor said, I need you to, you know, be in my pulpit, I need you to wear a suit. So I didn't want that box, but I didn't have all those. I didn't want that box of suits. But that's not what God said. I know. Because I didn't know why. I've been to some old churches, and they walk around here. Sometimes those fit shorts. It's not about what you wear. What is in your heart? What is in your heart comes out of your actions and your words. We're going to get to that in just one moment. Now, remember I said that joy is operational at all times, even in bad circumstances. The joy that the Holy Spirit can build up in us can encourage us to lift up our heads and forward on during the good and the bad times. Remember I told you about Apostle Paul was in jail. He pulled upon that, well, that before good happened. He was in a cold, damp jail. You think he was happy? Good happenings? That was bad happenings to him, but he had the joy of Christ.
Amen.
He said, I'm going to give it all to Jesus.
Amen.
To become more like Jesus. In my soul. That's what we're supposed to become. We always say in the prayer, oh, I'll become more like Jesus. We've got to make sure it's not just a figure of speech. I want to be more like Jesus. Well, you need to dust off your hands and your feet if they're dusty and get it busy. Apostle Paul, one of the guys of the Holy Spirit, has provided Roman Christians with what we need. That's all of us. We're all born Christians. We're not perfect, but we are moving towards perfection. We're continually moving forward, and then the fruit of the Spirit maturing us by through our dedication and commitment. Don't expect the fruit of the Spirit to develop in you, mature in you, and you are not doing anything. You'll complain, I'm going to get down to what we need to do. See, I just remember that. So what Apostle Paul tells us what we need to do to get this. I'm coming at you. I'm going to hold steady with you. It's coming. There are 4 points. I'm going to make sure you take those points down. Don't leave a service and you leave empty. You come in, let's say empty or half full, and you leave empty or half full. If you do, at least have to take those riches so you go home and get energized and all that build up from this. Let God build you up. Now, towards perfection, what we're striving for comes when we understand we're building up right now. We want to build up. We don't want to stay in the first grade all year, all month. We want to keep on moving. We don't want to stay. Now, I tell you one thing, if you stay too long in one spot, God don't want you there, guess what? Oh, he'll make it. Oh, God will make a way. I tell people, look, if God wants you at point B, and you won't go to point B, oh, God can use whatever. need you in this one right here. I can't go back to some things that made the past. Oh, no, God doesn't have it. Oh, no. You want to go back to the other world? You're going way beyond that in development. You see, you're not going to go, but no, you're not going back. Now, here. Paul gives us 4 points to remember and embrace if you want joy to grow to abundance in our lives. If you want joy to grow to abundance in our lives, and I got to bring these right here, also remember that the other 8 character traits produced through the Holy Spirit develop in step with joy. It ain't just joy by itself, but we're focusing on joy. Joy is the focal point. They all work in a chorus, like a chain. They all work together, one big whole. Joy, love, peace, long-suffering, they're all together. So when I talk about joy, I'm also talking about, indirectly, talking about the others. Love, you can't forget you have no joy, not no love, no peace. All that is working in hand in hand. So I just need you to remember. Now look, 4 steps, these 4 steps, you should embrace them if you want constant joy in your lives. Okay, the first point, look at, we go to scripture, don't just make up stuff, or just say what comes in our mind. If you have your Bibles, you look at Philippians 4:4. Okay, we talked 4:4, it says rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Now, step one, let your moderation be known unto all men, the Lord is at hand. In other words, be kind and gentle and behave toward others. Act like a child of God. And you don't realize that the number one commandment, love God with all heart, mind, body, soul, right? Number two, what? What's the number two? Love your neighbor as what?
Yourself.
Number one, what? Behave yourself around other people. Treat them respectfully. Love them. Be gentle. Love them. Treat them right. Treat them like you want to be treated. That's one thing, if you see people out there treat people like hell, you say, look, would you want to be treated like that? Well, sometimes I step wrong, God said, how would you like to step with you in that direction? I said, no, repent and move back. Okay, God, and sometimes we get a little above ourselves. I don't care what kind of growth you got, you still ain't perfect. Sometimes you start stepping in the wrong direction. The Holy Spirit has to bring that correction to remind you, bring remembrance of the word to help bring you back in line. Number one, it said be kind and gentle and behave or love your neighbors. Love other people. Act like a true child of God. Don't be playing no games, pretending. You can talk all the big flowery talk you want to, but people look at how you feel.
That's right.
I've heard people talk all kind of flowery talk, but you go in and ask them for help. Can you help this, sir? Oh. I got to go through a few of them big wigs. Walk away, they come in like peacocks. I'm such a big guy, great guy. I have done great things. Yes. And then lo and behold, that's when I came out of school. Oh, hey, can you open up a door for me here? The big peacock, suddenly you don't hear no big peacock talking no more. When you start asking me to work, for some good work coming out of it. That ain't no love, showing nobody no love. Talk to big flower, talk around them all the time, ain't going nothing for them. Ooh, go forth in health and strength. You go ahead, old brother and sister, in good health and strength. Now, how about people some dog old food? The man is raggedy, hungry. All that talk. People treating people, even in the church. I've seen it. I remember when I was a young man, a little bit younger, when I'd go through divorce. I never felt better towards my ex-wife now, but I had gone through and I went to a men's retreat. And I had a pastor, this is what a pastor told me. I was talking to the deacons. I had been a faithful servant in that church. Went to a retreat, retreat is what, you can be re-energized, right? And so I was talking, I was going through a little trouble here, I had a little trouble with it, I've gone through a divorce and whatnot. And this is what this pastor told me. It ain't all about you. It ain't about you. Hold on. This ain't about what's it about? I thought to myself, yeah, God said, I don't know what about it. God said, no. Hold on. Hold still. That's why I listened. Hold still. I said, now don't you remember what this man has done over years? He's done. He had a point. So he's played feet. First of all, you look past them, get a pencil. That let you know they should be on a pencil, right? Robert, thank you, sir. I didn't know. I'm thinking. I knew about that, but I was doing that in the sense. I couldn't see this pastor doing nothing wrong. But God showed me that that flaws are evident sometimes under stress. I don't know what kind of stress he's dealing with in his life at the time. But then later on, he said, he never apologized to me about that. But I didn't walk out. I said, I'm going to sit tight. I said, hold tight. I'm going to walk out of there. God said, sit tight. Woo! Okay. Let's get your shut the door. You know what, later on he said, he did make this concession. He said, you know what, we need to get a program. I thought about that. I need to get a program in place for the divorcees. You see, that God can use that moment. There's a moment that he needed right there. Whatever it was, God used that. And I'm so glad that I look back, I didn't walk out of there making a fool of myself, walking and being disobedient, walking out of there. So anyway, treating people, number one, love your neighbor as yourself. And that's how it sums it up. If you love somebody, then you're not going to do what? If you say love, you love your heart, love your neighbor as yourself, the number one, number two commandments, you won't fear that you're going to fall in line. If you love me, then you're not going to hurt me. You're not going to hate me. You're not going to steal from me. Jesus said, if you got these two right here, we're talking about love, you got all your heart, mind, and soul. And number two, what we're talking about right now, love your neighbor as yourself, then all things will follow, other commandments will follow from that. Number two, stop worrying about anything. Now, be concerned about things, but don't worry about things or events in your life. Be careful for nothing. Part A. Let's read that. Let's read it. Verse 6. Chapter 4, verse 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Instead of worrying, getting up, worrying, running around in circles, looking for other people to help you. Look, if God ain't gonna help you, ain't nobody gonna help you. God, if you're trying to push God faster than he wants to go, or whatever it is, but your faith and believe that God will, he loves you, and he will work on your behalf. All the words of that fellow said, worry, that's the top of the word, and you're forgetting about Philippians 4, 6. You're forgetting that same word. Be careful for that word. Don't worry about nothing. Yeah, don't be no fool now. Don't be concerned now. If you got people running around the yard out there. Now look now, you know, I'm just giving an example. You know you got to be, you don't worry at all, but you need to be concerned. Because you're getting killed by them, okay? Yeah. Or somebody in your pocket can get killed by them. You take action, you pray to God, but bring your supplication, bring your prayer to God. Now God will, then you will leave, the Holy Spirit will lead you from that point. Hopefully, when you go with the shotgun and get rid of them. I one day I had a dog that next to the neighbor dog had got out. There's a big old pit bull. I didn't want to get bit. I don't think the dog, I was a good kid, but I just don't want to get pinned up and have to go to the hospital. You know, but I said, I went in the hospital at 3 days. And I thought about it, and I said, no. I went there, put that thing down. No. The flesh wanted to pull that dog away. Nigga, I said, no. If God says, look, God's not a part of your life anyway, why did you pick it up? God does not allow me, it's not like a trigger or a happy person or whatever. But God's or whatever, right? He said, Lord, it's not a part of my life. He says, what I need you to do is run. No, I don't need you packing your guns or you have to go in your truck. I need you to run. Pray and then run. Okay, so we got that second step. Be careful for nothing. But be in prayer. Now look. And then the part B, actually, step number three is pray always. The first part A is be careful for nothing. Don't worry about nothing. Right? That's number two point. Be careful for nothing. In other words, don't worry about nothing. That's part A of that scripture. Part B, which is number three, pray always in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving that your request be known to God. In other words, don't worry about anything, but rather take all your concerns and frustrations to God in prayer. Take your supplications, your petitions, and you have something to say, oh God, I want to pray. God knows all my thoughts. He knows everything. Look, before the thousand on this earth. God knows everything, okay? But what he does, let me ask you, you talk to your best friends? Yeah, I talk to them. Who's better than your best friend? Oh, God. Jesus. What, you don't really talk to them? God wants you communicating with him. He knows what you're going to ask before you ask. That's not the point. The point is he wants you to communicate. If that was the case, God did. If you didn't have to pray, you could always come and sit in that chair and all pray. And just, oh, God knows what I need. I don't want to pray about that. And everything was falling. No. God didn't make us robust in the name. He don't want to make us any lazier than we already can be. Can you imagine if you didn't have to pray? I would sit here long enough. I could walk over to him. God's going to answer my prayer. God's going to help me now. No, God says God is a God of work. That little hammer you have right there, God is a God of work. God is a God, is not a lazy God. You look out here in nature, you think about all the little bitty insects. You ever seen a little bitty insect so small? You say, well, now how you putting it? How you putting energy with this here? Then you think about what you don't see, all the little microbes and germs. You get a microscope, you see something, it's like, what? That easily is like, now, if they ask this question, is that come from a lazy God? Think about humans. Think about his crown creation, humans. Oh, and Dr. Steele, I understand how all the brain, all the functions of the body work, all the mind, the intricate workings of the mind. God is in charge of all things. He's a supernatural God.
Amen.
God does not work on just the physical. That's what he's trying to get us to do. Don't just work in the physical. Work in a spiritual, supernatural realm. Okay, so now, then the other part of that verse says, then God will bring peace into life. That's if you bring prayer, you pray to God, thank you, God. Don't just pray to God. Don't come to God and say, God, give me the again. I got petitions. I need this, I need that again. God says what? It's a supplication and what? With what?
Thanksgiving.
That's like having a child walk around here all day long. You got a big old fat stomach walking around, got to put a hoop over his head, clothes on his feet. Clothes on the body, shoes on the feet, and the child walk around here, never say a word about nothing. Never thank you about nothing. I told him my son, I had given him a nice breakfast, and I said, and? Oh, God, thank you. I mean, come on, man, that isn't $10 to say, God. How's that looking? How does that look? God is doing all these things for us, and we ain't thanking God about nothing. Oh, more. How about you pray to God and put up some service to God?
Yeah. Amen.
It's always, I won't. You don't want to be in that mode. That mode, not that you know that's definitely broken. You're always in the mode of give me, and you ain't no, there's no thank you for it, but no service going forward. We all be people, the flesh can rise up in you people. We get lazy, we get shiftless, we get slothful. But we got to fight, that's the flesh rise up. God says you got, as a saved individual, you have power over the flesh if you exercise it and move towards it. Ask God to help you rise above that fleshiness. Sometimes that fleshiness rise up. If you want joy in our lives, it ain't happening if you live like hell. If you live like hell, you treat people like hell. How do you think love and peace, how do you think that's going to come in your life? You see somebody on the end that's in injury or whatever, or need help on the job or whatever. Oh, you said it, talk about it. Now, how are you going to get joy in your life? Who just connected to what, love? How are you going to get the peace in your life that's connected? Is that joy connected to what? I told you it's all connected. How are you going to get it? How are you going to get patience if you have no patience? How are you going to get joy if you have no patience? Level. We're working on you, but you need to say, Lord, oh, forgive me, Lord. Woo! I had a moment there, God. Thank you, the Holy Spirit. Get me by my neck. You bring me back down to earth. Help me, Lord. Forgive me for that tantrum. Help me to become more like Jesus. Don't be wrong about that, like you just said. I remember one time I was in the break room. I had a whole photo taken at Walmart. And I'm also, I told you I'm an ex-teacher, and I'm trying to have a license review and everything, but that's something that works. And I went to the prep room one day. And I also know it's a preacher too. They know it's a preacher. And I said, and there was an announcement that says a lady in a blue dress. 14, whatever. And I said, I'm walking down in a pretty mild, a pretty regular voice. Oh, the lady with the big butt. Come on, lady in the blue dress with the big butt. Boy, you should see all the ladies looking at me. They're like, and I said, oh, oh. Ooh, forgive me. I said, oh, I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry, man. And I woke up out of like this. I said, God, said, watch your mouth. You need to watch your attitude, your mouth. That mouth. And a moment we're going to tell you how words and actions are reserved upon thoughts in your head. Let's get to that. Okay. Now, the last point. This one right here is a powerful point that will govern a lot of things in your life. The final step in ensuring that joy will grow abundantly in your life, as well as in other eight character traits of Christ.
I said, Master, well, I'm late. I said, you're running late. You need to tell them to
sorry, first of all, you guys, sorry, guys, I didn't hear y'all. He said, you got to start getting yourself on up an idea a little bit sooner here. You got to start, you got to work on that. That's one of the things that I'm having to work on, being on time for help. Those little things right there are important because people's time is important. People think they need to talk start on time. Showing the love and respect for people by trying to be, trying to fall within the guidelines of being to operate. All right, now, these four steps can ensure that joy, along with the other eight character traits of Christ, can mature in you, in your life. You need to continue to follow the guidance of God and His Son, Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit, and can have the abundant, joyful life that Apostle Paul speaks about in the book of Philippians. Now, I want everybody to just raise your hand. Let's give God a praise and thanks. Lord, thank you for this another day of helping the Spirit, this revelation here. Let's give God some praise and thanks. Lord, thank you for all the blessings of this day, Father. Thank you for our message. Thank you for what you have done through the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We need to thank God throughout our lives. As you pray, you need to be thanking God. Now, today is also, we also need to make sure that, I don't know, we don't know if all people are saved. That's not our job, is to open the doors of the church. It's to ask people to realize that God sent His only begotten Son to this earth to die for our sins. But He didn't stay dead. He resurrected. God got His raised His Son up to abundant life, to everlasting life.
Amen.
We must remember that God says you can have the same thing, but you have to first accept Jesus Christ, repent of sin, and accept Jesus Christ into your life. Say, I want you saved. I want my life, my sins to be washed away. I know that you died on the cross. I know that you rose again to an eternal life. Help me, Lord. Thank you. Please forgive me for sin. I want to become a child of God. I want you as my Savior.
Amen.
So today, if there's anybody that's unsaved, have not made that pronouncement in their heart, there's opportunity. There's always help while there's life.
Right.
You're in death, there's no more help if you have not got help while you are alive. So if you are not saved today, we want you to come on up and accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior if you are not and accepted Jesus as your Savior. There's an opportunity. When you have died and gone and you have not accepted Jesus Christ in your life, then there's not eternal life, but eternal death. But then while we are alive, that's one of the great commissions that God gave us, to go out and tell the people about Jesus Christ, about the gospel, about how that you would abide to us, that you would have eternal life with God forever and ever.
Amen.
That's one of the most important parts of the message. We talk about joy and all the accompanying elements of the fruit of the Spirit. But that does not take a part of your life until you have become saved. That is the message for saved people. You grasp salvation and come down. Salvation is not something that you can earn. It's something which you have to accept. You have to give your heart to Christ. You have to want to forgive, want to let the sin, want to turn your life over to Christ. We see the none that come, and whatever the case is, I thank God for this allowing you all to come out today, and hopefully the message here on joy, with the other, I would say in parentheses, the other accompanying eight aspects, the traits of Jesus, you know, it takes a lifetime of development, but you have to move towards it purposely. You're not going to get the joy, the love, the peace in your life by being a lazy Christian, by being a non-responsive Christian. Whenever there's a need, Apostle Paul, you know, said, I give it all up. All this stuff is like known to me. Sometimes I say, well, I ain't quite like that. I feel like I know I need to. I know what the standard is. God needs to be first. And see, if you put stuff other, so I'm constantly trying to dump all the stuff out of the way. I need Sunday came around, and turn on God, turn on God. Purposeful, but if you just go through and just keep on going to peace all the time, then God said, after God, look, hold on. I need you. Growth is not going to peace all the time. I need you to calm down here. So he said, don't bring it. And what I would say is on the side. The great one of the things that I have to work on is when people come against me wrong, they step to me wrong, I don't want to argue with that. Argue it down. God says, look here now. Look. One day, if I'm about two or three weeks ago, I came to a point, the Holy Spirit said, look here, I am so tired. You know, aren't you tired of that by rising up when people upset you? There's no joy, there's no peace. He said, you know what? There's a point. The devil knows where you are with that. And I finally said, Lord, I know I can be a hard-hitting individual. I know. I have to admit it. You got to admit it. You are whatever trouble you're going through, you got to admit it. To God, Lord, I know. I even admit to people, I know I'm wrong to handle. I will. You say something wrong. Oh, I will be fussing with you until the day until the chickens come up the roost or whatever. God said, man, that was my point. He said, God, Holy Spirit said, yeah, that's what the devil got you. He knows when he go to pieces, when people start becoming wrong, a situation, especially for people, they're for people. That's what comes for people. He said, that's the one that you should love, but that's the ones that you go to pieces with, that you argue with, like you. And I came to grips with that, Holy Spirit. And don't you know, a peace came over me.
Amen.
And whenever I see that situation rise up in me, I break it. He says, come on, bring it back down. So I want to thank God. So I'm going to say like this purposefully. When you know you got problems, whatever troubles are in your life that keep you from growing, you got to attack that. The devil is more stricter right there where you are. So I want to thank you for your time and energy. May God give you all the blessings. May you take the word, God's word, and may you flourish. Thank you so much for your time.
Go ahead and play, if you will, just that song. I'll just give you a minute. If you want to come down to the altar and pray, and Lyle, if you kind of come down and close our service, praying for our offertory. But just take this time again. If you were moved by what Brother Robert shared with us this morning about joy, and he spoke power as well. So take that time and spend some time with the Lord and say, Lord, what do I need to do to correct that? Is there something I need to do different? Something I need to change about those four steps that he gave us something to do. So let's take a minute and just pray. Thank you again, Brother Robert, and I'm going to ask if you would, if you feel comfortable, if you want to go to the back door, and the people can, they won't shake your hand, maybe they can elbow bump. Yeah, whatever you want to do. But thanks for coming this morning. Don't forget, tonight is a Bible study with Bobby Watkins, leading that, and a business meeting. We'll see you tonight at 6 p.m.